Something about man that makes him want to risk his life. What it is, we're not quite sure. But there's always someone with the philosophy, the greater the risk, the greater the reward. Sometimes financial, more often glory, and many times personal injury or even death. Maybe it's the flirtation with death that drives some men to an emotional high and the dismissal of fear. Some say it's the relationship a person has with a machine, which is out of control for a few moments, determining his destiny. This is one such man, Joseph W. Einhorn. They called him Super Joe. His story is one that chronicles the explosive thrill of motorcycle jumping. A warehouse worker from San Pablo, California, in the early 1970s, Joe decided to be somebody. After practicing ramp-to-ramp motorcycle jumping in the desert, Joe headed for San Jose for his first professional jump. If he was frightened, he never showed it. It was to be a long jump, over 16 cars. It was a distance that no one had ever reached before, including Evel Knievel. The jump was in front of a national television audience and was tremendously successful. He landed perfectly. Everything had gone just as he had hoped. He called himself Super Joe, and he was on his way. From that day forward, his life would change drastically. He would become somebody, but there would be dues to pay. But none of that was in Joe's crystal ball. He saw only a glorious future. Joe's second jump was on a gravel road over a number of trucks. Soaring through the air, Joe knew it wasn't quite right. The speed was perfect, but the rough road conditions had thrown him off to the side. He missed the catch ramp and went headlong into the gravel. Then, struck by the motorcycle, he had met with his first failure. His back was broken, his face lacerated. He would spend a month in the hospital and several months on the mend. But his spirits remained high. He had now faced adversity, but was willing to try again. In the mid-1970s, Joe was making one successful jump after another. Small towns, big cities. He became a media favorite, and the crowds loved him. It was 10% jumping and 90% promoting. By now, other jumpers had come along, and Evel Knievel had continuously jumped further than anyone. It was time for another record jump on national television. From Lancaster Speedway in Buffalo, New York, Joe, at age 28, would attempt to jump over 15 buses. A special ramp was built. It was to be his best payday to date. Hospital bills and traveling expenses had eaten away at his bank account. This would be the longest jump ever for anyone. Joe stayed busy, psyching himself up and the crowd as well. He felt confident and seemed to have discharged any feeling of fear. If he could pull this one off, it would be over 170 feet, a new record. If he didn't, it could mean the end of a career that seemed to be headed toward fame and fortune. Joe's method was simple. Prepare as best you can, then don't think about it, just go for it. Aim the motorcycle, hit the right speed, and hang on. He'd come a long way now from being a weekend amateur racer to a professional motorcycle jumper, right up there with the best of them. His heart was pumping hard. As the motorcycle, perfectly tuned, never skipped a beat, it was the moment of truth. One last quick look. Then just do it. Don't think about it. Just do it. Get the speed now. 85 miles an hour. This is something you don't practice. Just hit the ramp and hope all goes well. The landing is hard. Joe can't hang on. The motorcycle slams into the right side wall. Joe's leather suit protects him as he slides safely to a stop. He will go down in the Guinness Book of World Records for having achieved the longest motorcycle jump ever. Another look shows us Joe's speed was right on. He had lined himself up perfectly with the ramp, and it too did its job, pitching Joe to the exact height he needed to get over the buses. The landing was hard. He just couldn't hang on, but it was a record. Just outside of Chicago, Joe jumped for the last time. He had ridden his well-used motorcycle up a patched ramp. The front wheel hit the top of the receiving ramp, then flipped over. That night, Joe hadn't checked things over as he usually did. There just didn't seem to be any fear in him.
Everything we need in the hospital.
All right. Give me some people on the side for me here.
Fear serves a purpose, and I've rid my body of it, but perhaps that wasn't a smart thing to do, because there's certain times in your life that you shouldn't be afraid. And man's main instinct, same with an animal, man and animal, same instinct, main instinct. It's not to collect money or love, it's for survival. It's your first instinct. And I think myself as an animal, and I keep that instinct in mind as a survivor. Most people take, you know, all your businessmen and everything, they take for granted waking up tomorrow morning. You know, they know they're going to wake up tomorrow morning, and the lady's going to bring breakfast to them. They're lucky. But poor old me, I'm going to be awful thankful if I'm around here tomorrow morning.
I'll get a pulse rate on him as soon as I can.
It was 1976. Joe had big plans, all of which came crashing down with his motorcycle on this night. Joe was in a hospital for 3 months. He had bruised his brain. He had a long way to go to get his coordination back. He had to relearn everything from walking to talking. For 3 months, he was in therapy at a rehabilitation center in Chicago. Finally, the day came. Joe was released and allowed to go back to California. It was a somber end to his flashy career. Joseph W. Einhorn, Super Joe. Today he lives quietly in a small California town with the glory of his past.
You're about to see Auto Rodeo Vaz performing for the first time outside of the Soviet Union. Auto Rodeo Vaz is a demanding sport that calls for tremendous physical concentration and skill from the performers. The Soviets call them jigits, which loosely translated means cowboys. Most of the action takes place as the cars are traveling on two wheels. In the Soviet Union, they call it two-wheel touring. In the United States, we call it high skis. But no matter what you call it, it's pure excitement. Well, starting off in close procession on their two-wheel tour is four cars high, making pretty good time around this Pacific Bowl. This is a relatively small arena that was built on the site of past Canadian expositions, and for these cars working in such a confined space here today is really an extraordinary feat in itself.
You know, the 10 automobiles we're going to be seeing perform were all manufactured by the Lada factory in the Soviet Union, then transported by ship to Canada, especially for this tour. They use three different models here. The white cars are Samaras. They have front-wheel drive, and they're a little less flexible. The red cars all have four-wheel drive, and they're called Nevas. And then there are the Signets, which are the station wagons.
Well, that's a mouthful. I don't know. If I look at, looking at all of them, they look kind of like Fiats to me.
Well, they kind of are, Dan. The Russians bought the rights to use the Fiat 124 body style. And with their 1,500cc engines, 92-inch wheelbase, and tough all-steel construction, they make a fleet of pretty mean machines.
And you can see the audience really appreciates their efforts here. Now, here's a hair-raising balancing act to get us started, a lot tougher than Fiddler on the Roof. It's called the helmet toss. The performer crawls out and stands on the car.
The driver inside the car reaches out and picks up a helmet that's been set out on the track, tossing it up to his teammate standing on top. Pretty scary.
Well, let's see what happens here. There's the first one. He did good, didn't he?
Oh, my God.
Now, the stunt ends with a spectacular finish, but I'm not going to tell you about that until after we get the second helmet up here. Here he comes. There it is. And a little toss.
Ho-ho!
Nice job. Watch this now. This is a young lady named Lisa. She's coming right into the frame. Here comes the car. Easy does it. Whoops.
Oh, my goodness.
A little close, huh?
There are 12 members of this troop. Three Nikolais. Two Sergeys, is she all right? Alexander, Yuri, Vasily, Vadim, Mikhail, Slava, and that's Lisa. Lisa Popov is the only woman performer. When we talked to her earlier, she said she joined the team as a driver and is still developing her two-wheel driving technique while working as a performer. She's been practicing since last year. And what about the risk she takes standing in front of a moving car? Well, she'd never been hit until today.
Yeah, today's a first for her. I would imagine those knees are going to be a little on the sore side. But, as we all know, the Russians are tough. We're ready to go on to the next act now. As we take a look again at the racetrack, you see two cars. Our next stunt is called a real cliffhanger. This is Mikhail, I believe his name is, on top of a car. And as you can see, one vehicle is on two wheels while the other is tucked right in next to it. Fantastic piece of precision driving.
It's wonderful how both vehicles and people are synchronized so well together. It must take hours of practice.
Well, it's true. Practice makes perfect, as you see right here. You know, every member of the troop started out as an ordinary worker in the assembly line at the Lotta factory. Ooh, nice job here. And that's how they get started doing stunt work in the Autovaz.
Well, you know, people from all over the world are obviously enjoying this in the audience. It's nice that the people back home got a chance to see this, too, on Superchargers.
Now, you know, most of the stunts you see here have been perfected by the Russians, and I have never seen auto daredevils do any of the things that these people are doing here today. This is called the trap, and it's quite extraordinary. As you can see, one Russian here now is actually holding up a car. Now he sends it underway as another one comes along, and they're going to call this side saddle.
It looks very dangerous. You might not want to try it at home. Whoop.
Be careful.
Okay, up there?
Yeah, he's going to be just fine. Now, he'll be joined up there by the driver. Watch this. There's the two of them. Picking up a little
quick
applause.
Bow. There you go.
Now, the question is, how do they get the red car off the white car?
Very carefully. Very, very carefully.
Well, that's right. Actually, there's a little horn honk, and then the one car will pull off. It'll be the red car. He'll turn the, see, turns the wheels towards the white car, and it just pulls him right off. Very nice. Very well
done.
Wow. And, of course, the crowd, again, appreciates it.
Now we have a pair of cars performing in 360-degree circles. They're really close together there.
Well, they surely are, and they're going to get closer and closer to that wall. You watch. They are just precision drivers par excellence. This is a stunt that the Russians call dancing cars. Now, if you listen real, real close, you'll be able to hear the anniversary waltz playing in the background.
The two automobiles are actually dancing. It looks so simple, but it's really an incredibly difficult feat of driving.
Well, it certainly is, and just like the Bolshoi Ballet, the harder you practice, the easier it looks.
I wonder if Baryshnikov got his start that way.
Well, you never know. He may have seen this show a few years back and decided, hey, that's something I can do, and he took his act on into the United States, if I recall.
Here again, I find it amazing how both cars seem to be moving together. The drivers can't even see each other. How do you think they do that, Jim?
Well, now, that is a well-kept Russian secret. Only the drivers know, and they're not telling anybody. But here's a little secret I'll share with you. You know, most times when you pull up to a gas station to put air in the tires, you know you have to put in 32 pounds of air, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, when these guys pull up to the gas station, they have to put in anywhere from 80 to 90 pounds of air in those tires to keep those cars up on the sides. Now, watch this car. This car is going up on two wheels and will go around the arena the way we've been watching here this afternoon. The other car comes from the opposite direction. This is what the Russians like to call KISS. I think you're going to find this very interesting. What could they possibly end up doing at the center of the arena? We'll see here in just a second. You can see now, that's called passenger side high. The other car is driver side high as the two of them come real close to each other. Watch very carefully now. The other car coming from the opposite direction. Will they stop in time?
No.
Watch carefully. Bingo. Not bad. Nice round of applause.
I think I've done that several times on the expressway.
Now, I was told in a secret meeting that they have actually kissed. I mean, they have clicked bumpers and broken some headlights from time to time. But now the next stunt is getting off to a flying start, and it's really a toughie.
And this is called, what else? The high ladder stunt. You have Slava and Mikhail balancing on a ladder approximately 11 feet in the air.
How do you get these names down so well? I'm having a terrible time with these Russian names.
You're
doing a good job.
It's my foreign policy, Jan.
All right. We're going to keep our eye on this little white car now as he comes screaming towards our two performers standing on that ladder about 11 feet in the air. Look out.
Whoa! Bang. Two perfect landings.
Absolutely. Great. You'd have thought they were up in outer space when they came down. Excellent job.
Just another day.
All right. Here now is something that I love. This is my favorite. And I don't know how skilled it is, but it's my favorite. This is called walking the dog.
I think that's even worse than being dragged around in a circle by my two Rottweilers.
Now, Rottweilers, a lot of people don't know that, but those are very big dogs.
Oh, they're built like big bears.
Chicago bears.
They're not that tough. Right.
Well, this is called, as I said, walking the dog. Now, here's how he does this. First of all, he has got a little lash or leash, if you will, on the steering wheel, and the other one is, you saw the one in his hand?
Uh-huh.
Well, that's a fix to the accelerator, and he can just spin that car all day long with those two little pieces of wire. Now for something very special. Watch the performer as he dodges into the inside of the white car. The two cars will meet a little bit later on, but first our performer, his name is Vasily, is going to do something vastly different.
He is standing on his head on a moving car. I don't believe it. This is better than Barnum and Bailey.
Well, keep watching, because it does get better. When the white car gets close enough, he's going to attempt to jump from one moving vehicle to the other. Now, he's completed the headstand. Watch him very carefully.
You know, I've seen this in movies before, but I have never seen this live. Keep your fingers crossed. Ho-ho!
You did it.
Good show, Tovarish. That's Russian for comrade.
Well, you've really got this Russian stuff down pat. I'm getting a little shaky here.
I'm working on it.
Here's a nice bow. Vasily, taking a nice bow.
He's looking good. You know, no doubt about it. The whole team has a really slick look about it.
And you're going to love this one. This is called Changing Tires.
Changing a tire isn't something I'd do under any circumstance.
Well, you sound like most women. Women do not like to change tires.
Hey.
Well, now these three guys are going to do it the hard way, though. You keep your eye on them. That's Nikolai. You remember him? He's on the hood there in the red coat. He and his other comrade there are taking the lug nuts off the tires, and pretty soon they'll throw them right down on the racetrack or the padded apron area. So this is going to get real interesting.
Well, think of all the times they save by not using a jack.
Well, that's true.
What if they drop something?
Well, they're going to drop the tires right now. There they go.
Whoa-hoo!
Now, take a real good look. These are just the hubs of the wheel, and as you can see, they're spinning around. Now, the next question is...
One down. What's next?
Well, next is, where do we get two new fresh tires from?
Good question.
Well, if you keep your eye, you're going to see now. Well, one of the fellows is digging away in the back trunk there, and he's going to come up with two brand new tires.
I don't believe that. Look at him.
Yeah, this is working out excellent now. They get those two tires on by the time they get around and bring it on down. Why, we're going to see four heroes there, including our driver.
That is remarkable. That is amazing.
Let's see now. Evidently, the guy in the middle figures his job is all finished, so he's just going to stand tall and look proud at the crowd.
And maybe watch his footing.
Yeah, he's going to have to be real careful now because Nikolai indicated the job is finished, and you can see two fresh tires on the car. And let's see if they bring it down. Let's see if it holds up. Down it comes. Beautiful. Well done. Nice job.
Do you think they're ready to become a picture at Indianapolis here?
Well, now, you may have struck on something there. That would really be exciting. An Indianapolis race car team from the Soviet Union. That'd be pretty special, wouldn't it?
Well, that tire changing stuff was really a showstopper.
Well, it certainly was, but get ready, because you haven't seen anything yet. We are about to get ready with the final. Now, I want you to keep your eyes on these cars, because we're going to put 12 Russians into one lot of car.
Is that a trick?
Well, not exactly. It's called 12 on a car, and it's the finale.
Okay. Let's count.
Well, let's see. You got one.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
Okay, there's eight, and then I count the driver and two on the inside.
Okay, well,
that's
11, Jim.
We're missing one. We have one missing Russian. But what a nice job they did.
Eight and three is 11. Yeah, 11.
Oh, there they go. Oh, they're in trouble there for a moment. Come all the way to the finale and turn the car upside down. Nice job, 11 of them.
Oh, no way.
There's number 12 coming out of the trunk. That's Nikolai, the motorcycle rider.
There you have it, the magnificent performers of the Auto Rodeo Vibe taking a well-deserved bow after their premier performance in Vancouver, British Columbia.
The International Congress of Daredevils, organized by B. Ward Beam back in August of 1923 in Toledo, Ohio, starred barnstorming pilots, wingwalkers, motorcyclists, and other sorts. It's recognized as the first official thrill show in history, filling a basic human need. The organized shows continued to evolve. More and more spectacular stunts were added to the repertoire. Jimmy Lynch joined the Barney Oldfield Thrill Show at the Chicago World's Fair in 1934. He created many of the traditional stunts, such as firewall, head-on crashes, and rollovers. A contemporary of Lynch was Burl Lucky Teeter, who was killed in 1942 at the Indiana State Fair while doing a ramp-to-ramp jump. Joie Chitwood stepped in and bought Teeter's equipment, giving up a racing career that had seen him win three AAA championships and finish in the money 9 out of 10 times at the Indianapolis 500. The first show of the Chitwood Auto Daredevils was held July 4th, 1943, establishing a tradition that continues to this day. Now, let's take a look at the Joie Chitwood Thrill Show of the 80s. Here's announcer Al Doheny.
And now, to officially commence the show, in true Indianapolis tradition, gentlemen, start your engines!
Here we go. heading down the straightaway, thundering down the track. Here they come, folks. They're on their way, lining up. Driving with one hand at all times, these four great drivers. Down the track they come, faster and faster with every turn of the wheel, approaching the first elevation of the left wheels on the ramps this time. Here we go, go, go! Watch it, look out! A grueling ordeal of man and machine. From the movie lots of Hollywood, the proving grounds of Detroit, and the racetracks of the world, they come to thrill you this afternoon, folks, as they thrilled millions throughout the world. World-famous Joie Chitwood, Danger Angels, the greatest name in thrill show history, the greatest show on wheels. This is a show that thrilled 115,000 people at the Giant Astrodome in Houston, Texas, two nights in succession. It was standing room only audiences, gasping in utter disbelief at the driving skill of these Danger Angels. Here they come again, watch them, weaving in and out, twisting and turning, maneuvering. The guy falls. Hey, those Chevys must respond instantaneously to the driver's will. The slightest miscalculation and anything can happen. The modern version of the Roman steeplechase is indeed a far cry from the old Roman era of, say, Van Hurst's time when they used chariots drawn by horses. This is the rocket age, the space age of speed and power. Plenty of speed and power in those Chevys, riding on those Cooper tires, gripping, clutching, clawing that surface. Lining up now side by side, two cars thrown bumper to bumper, all clustered together. With a burst of surging power, they come heading for the first elevation. Watch it, we could have instant disaster out there. Ladies and gentlemen, you know these Joie Chitwood with Danger Angels, these daredevils, these stuntmen that you're witnessing in action here this afternoon. They're not the ordinary run-of-the-mill fly-by-night performers by any means. Oh, no indeed, folks. They make numerous television commercials, safety and otherwise. You've seen them appear on many segments of Chips, PM Magazine, etc. Watch them. Here we go, go, go! Watch it, fellas. Now, which way did they go, George? Oh, boy. We move along now to a stunt that defies imagination. You're about to witness a human battering ram perform human flesh and bone in the person of teenage daredevil Matt Huff of Topeka, Kansas. Matt Huff clinging to the old stock car being provided here by the Chevrolet dealers of Greater Indianapolis. The driver of that automobile is Brian Carson of Van Nuys, California. Notice the barricade out there constructed of heavy timber. It's been saturated with Sunoco gasoline. It'll soon be ignited, blazing furiously. There's going to be hot splintering boards flying in every direction. Here they come. They're about to go through a terrifying, fiery ordeal, an inferno! Ladies and gentlemen, you saw for yourselves, with your very own eyes, the human battering ram, believe it or not. And it looks like they're none the worse for wear in spite of the ordeal coming back. I know we're going to have a real rip-roaring, rousing, hale and hearty, really warm Indianapolis, Indiana reception for two red-blooded American fellows, two really game guys, Matt of the human battering ram and his driver, Brian Carson. All right, folks, once again, watch Tim Chitwood. As he attempts reverse spins, he's going to accelerate faster and faster, back, 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 in one fell swoop. He'll attempt to spin the car around and head in the opposite direction, like so, and he's off and running in a cloud of dust. Probably take me about a minute or two to turn around out there. Of course, I'm not Tim Chitwood. He's going to try to roll that car wheel to wheel. He's heading up the ramp. He's going up and over, going, and he's slithering down the track on his roof. Unfortunately, he didn't make it wheel to wheel, ladies and gentlemen. This happens occasionally. By wheel to wheel, we mean he must roll the car over completely, coming to rest in an upright position on all four wheels at the conclusion of the roll, ready to roll again if the car is still negotiable. Ladies and gentlemen, if he could have maneuvered, continued to steer and guide it, you would have continued rolling it until it was completely demolished. We all have to go sometime, folks. That car is real gone. But J.L. Martin, ladies and gentlemen, one of the nation's foremost crash roll artists, attained 3 points here this afternoon that he can add to the others that he's already accumulated. Boing. He's gunning the motor down the track. He comes. All eyes on Brian Carson. Watch him. Here he goes. Hey. Crescendo crushing steel, ladies and gentlemen. That was a Hollywood flavor. These are tense moments as you wait the outcome. He's emerging unscathed, the indestructible, big, bad, bashful Brian Carson does it again. Everything has to
to be scientifically calculated, perfectly coordinated, precisely executed if he's to survive. These are deadly serious moments. Clown Dave Roberts, the licensed fireworks technician, he's still in makeup out there. He's in charge of detonating the propulsion blast. In my opinion, Tim Chitwood is a sheer genius. He holds a degree in mechanical engineering. Here he comes in a blaze of glory. The entry players have been ignited. Will he have the proper speed? Will he be able to do it? It's the moment of truth. Good luck, Tim. Beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, you saw the Chevy Chevette walk-up son of a gun. Aerial rocket leap skillfully and successfully negotiated here this afternoon. Get a show where all the stuntmen are superb. Tim Chitwood, the world's number one ranked stuntman, is magnificent.
You know, it takes a special performer who can act when the action gets rough. And I'm talking about stunt performers. Stunt people are a breed unto themselves. They're the ones who can take a fall for a star or start a fight in a motion picture. And these are a very special group of individuals. And here at Universal, you'll find them performing in live shows each and every day. Let's take a look. This is the Conan Stage Show, a live performance before your very eyes, complete with lasers and fire as Conan battles the evil dragon. The stunt performers really get a workout. Another exciting stunt show at Universal is Miami Vice, where again, the stunt performers prove to be exceptional. Just watch the action. Well, as you can see, those stunt performers provide more action than you'd find in a war zone. Now, these folks have just been through Universal Studios' all-new Earthquake. It's the big one. This earthquake goes off the Richter scale and takes you with it. The world around you is devoured by this natural disaster. However, as in all good Hollywood plots, you will survive. Special effects like earthquake, or gags as they're called here in the movies, are built one time just for the movies, with the exception of earthquake here at Universal. It performs every time for every tram. You know, stunt performers have been working in the movies ever since day one, and that was well over 100 years ago. Stunt performers are a very unique and, of course, a very important part of the movie-making process. Hope you enjoyed today's show. Hope you'll join us again next time here on The Superchargers. I'm Dan Gabriel.